Dragi telespectatoare, dragi telespectatori, sunt Rodica Baciu și cu multă bucurie vă invit să urmăriți o nouă ediție a emisiunii Pentru Noi Femeile. Mă bucur ori de câte ori întâlnesc telespectatoare și telespectatori care ne confirmă că urmăresc cu mult drag emisiunile noastre. Mă bucur că aici la Credo TV, în studioul dedicat emisiunii Pentru Noi Femeile, e un punct în care se întâlnesc femei, dar și bărbați, de pe toate colțurile globului. Și astăzi avem o surpriză deosebită pentru dumneavoastră, o invitată originară din Ghana, care locuiește în Olanda, o femeie a lui Dumnezeu, împreună cu fiica ei, sunt invitatele noastre. Alături de mine în studio se află doamna Rose Fer din Olanda, mamă a doi copii și fiica ei este astăzi cu noi, soție de pastor și foarte preocupată de mijlocire, rugăciune, domeniul profetic și studiul cuvântului lui Dumnezeu. Rose a absolvit un master în teologie și se bucură să încurajeze femei din toate țările prin care ajunge să-L cunoască pe Dumnezeu mai profund, să citească cuvântul, să se roage și să aibă o viață aproape de Domnul. Îi mulțumesc Domnului pentru că a adus-o pe Rose a doua oară în România și la Credo TV. Alături de ea este Andreea, tânără studentă, și mă bucur să o văd călcând pe urmele mamei sale. Welcome, Rose. I just told a few words about you and about your daughter, Andrea. I'm very happy to have you the second time here in our studio and to listen from your experience with God. I'm very happy, and I know you are more happy like the first time because you are together with your daughter.
Yes, yes.
First, I want to ask how you find motivation to do so many things for women, but first for God.
It's always a great privilege, you know, to do something for God. And before I even talk, I just want to thank you always for the opportunity you give us, and it's God using you in our lives, and I'm really, really grateful for that. Thank Jesus for providing this way. Like you were saying about motivation, I think there's one thing that will motivate anybody, and that's what motivates me. It's every time when I think about what Jesus did for me on the cross of Calvary. Anything I'm going through, when I think about that, I just get motivation. Because if He gave everything for me, then what can stop me from doing my part for His sake? That's why I do what I do.
And from this motivation comes out so many fruits, so many things.
Yes.
And please let us know more about the conference you will be part next week.
Yes, like you know, the Lord made it so amazingly. I don't know how to even express this, how miraculous God connected us. And through that, the last time when I came, we went to Mamea together, and I was really touched. I saw that there is a wave of women, and that is, I will even call it a type of revival there. And I was so built up. Fortunately, I could get translation from you and other sisters. Everybody was loving. I just loved the conference president and all the speakers. Everybody there was like spirit-filled. They were really alive in Christ. And the word was flowing, powerful word, but life-transforming word. And for mothers, for singles, for every type of woman, it was just a woman thing. But also you could see that it was a group of a mass of women, because the number was great, that were just You talk about motivated by love, by their love for Jesus, and just gathered there to just talk about the Word of God. It was so amazing. And by the grace of God, I just got to know I'm allowed to speak there. And it was so, I don't know. It was really, really joy in my heart. But also, I said, Lord, what an opportunity. So if I'm here today and just on the way to Mamea, but we will not go to Romania without passing through your place. So this is why we are here.
Yes. And this this time is very special. Yes. Because another sweet person from your family comes with you.
Yes.
Andreea, let me know how you feel in Romania because you are here for the first time.
Yes. Well, Romania is very nice. I never thought I would come to Romania, but yeah, I'm here now and it's pleasant. People are very kind and warm and welcome me like I'm their own, so I really don't feel like a foreigner. And yeah, I just enjoy my stay until now. Yeah, it was great.
I'm sure if you started so good, so after finishing a week here, you will be with a lot of nice remembers.
Yes, yes, I will have that for sure. That's true.
Rose, please let us know what subject do you study now from the Word of God, because I know you better as I know your daughter, yes. But I know you are in love with the Word of God.
Yes. In actual fact, like you are saying, every time I take a book and of the Bible and or a chapter or something, and I just get caught up and study this word. And one of them is about the 10 virgins, which I've been looking up just before I'm coming here. And it's really gave me some wake up call, you know, even though I'm always in the Word, and really think that everybody must even go back to read it, you know. And that's Matthew chapter 25, verse 1 to 13. And it's about one of the parables that Jesus told. It's about 10 virgins. And it's all about the kingdom of God and how it works. So, but this particular parable has got to do with one of the end time stories that Jesus was telling his disciples about, because they wanted to know when the end will come. So Jesus reacted to them, and it was through that he told this parable to them. Yes.
This is at the end of Matthew writing.
Yes.
And it's the last days when Jesus was with his disciples.
Yes.
What do you think now when we are closer to the back coming of the Lord?
Yes.
What type of season it's coming? What we have to expect?
Yes. In actual fact, when you look at Matthew 24, that's when Jesus was talking to these disciples, really explaining to them about the end time. And he told them specifically that no one knows when is the exact time that the end is coming. And he said, even not the angels. And that's quite interesting. He even said that he himself didn't know. He said only the Father knew, but now Jesus knows, because Jesus is in heaven and is seated right at the right hand side of the Father, and he's interceding for us. So he knows when he's coming, but by then he was on earth, he said that. And so he was answering the disciples about this particular question. So this is what it's very important to know. The exact day is not told, but he gave signs. He explained, he elaborated and gave a little bit clue about what will be surrounding those times. And but I think that even when we go further in the book of Matthew, the same Matthew 24 verse 14, he talks about the necessity of the gospel being preached, and that the end will come. The gospel needs to cover the whole world, every corner of the world. Then the end will come. But in actual fact, if we will be playing this gospel, I think it's almost all, it's all over the world. I think so. People, I know that there are still people groups that need to be reached out. But if we will really, really be specific, we will say the gospel's gone far. So we will say we are around the end time signs, but the exact day we don't know. And that's what is very, very confronting, that because we don't know, we must be prepared.
But what kind of preparation we have to do?
Preparation's got to do with really just get to do, really live real as a Christian. And when you look at the story of the 10 virgins, if we should just go quickly to that particular one, we will see that Jesus gave examples of 10 virgins. Five of them were foolish and five were wise. Why? It was because these five, maybe you're going to come to the significance, but it's got to do with the ones that were wise, they fixed their eyes on Jesus. So preparation's got to do with fixing your eyes on Jesus. So I think this is the time that all Christians must know that it's time to fix your eyes on Jesus fully. And when we want to explain that, it means you should really live in the Spirit. You should be constantly filled with the Spirit. You should be having, you make sure that you are really saved. Make sure that the saving power of Jesus Christ is working through you. Make sure that you've made Jesus Christ your Lord and personal Savior. It's very, very important, and living according to the Word of God, you know. So that's the preparation and bearing, so that the Holy Spirit, I mean, because when you are really living for Him, the Holy, it means the Holy Spirit is working through Him and that through you. And it is through that you bear fruit. So you don't bear the fruit, but the Spirit bears this fruit through you that will let you live a life that is acceptable, or a life that is prepared to meet the Lord.
In our days, everything is planned. Everything.
Yes.
And why God don't give us a fixed day or some details to be better prepared? Why this is a secret according what it's written in the Bible?
God doesn't want us to live by making choices to live today as a worldly person, or tomorrow I live like a Christian. That's not the purpose. God expects that you accept Jesus and He becomes all your life. So you live a permanent life as a child of God. You are saved, and you must be serious every day. There's no time. When you look at the structure of the church today, you will see that there are people in church, they go to church, can be so many years, they are not transformed. And transformation has got to do with really being allowing the Lord, or the Lord Jesus, to be your Lord. It is then that is obeying His commandments. He said, if you love me, you obey my commandments. So obey His word and live in the word. And then you will see that it should be a consistent life, a life that you live normally. A Christian must have a life that you live normally, and everything should be normal, and not that today I can do this, tomorrow I can sin, tomorrow I'll do that, and you don't even know what you are about. So it's very important that we, once Christians, we remain Christians. We need to live truly.
A permanent relationship
with
God.
The Lord. Yes.
This is the point.
Yes.
And I think this story with the 10 virgins, it's connected with the verse 36 from the previous chapter 24.
Yes.
That you already mentioned.
Yes. Yes.
Maybe you can develop a little bit. Who knows? Only one who knows the day.
Yes. Jesus was saying only the Father knows. And of course, he gave a lot of signs. He talked about all these wars, all these awful things that we're going through. There's a lot happening. You have rumors of war, you've got terrorism, you've got criminality, you've got fightings here and there, farming, disasters, natural disasters and human-made disasters, because there are some disasters that are not made by naturally. For example, when people are suffering from digging of gas from the underground and houses are shaking, it's because you dug there. But it's all activities of men. So all these things are part of the signs that Jesus said will happen. But they are just happening, you know. There's a lot of chaos here and there. But and there will be false teachings, false prophets. When you read all these things, there'll be a lot of things happening. But it still says it's not yet, you know. It says it's the beginning of sorrows, rather, you know. But like I was saying, still he says he won't tell. And I think that there is the need for us to leave the things that God doesn't want to reveal to us. Leave it to God. Let God be who he is. He is God. And what he knows we can carry, he allows us to know. And when he says, wait, and I won't tell you why, we need to just be obedient and have peace with it. And he doesn't ask anything from us. He just says we should be prepared. So I think He hasn't even left us without an answer. We, in the course of not knowing, the best thing is that just get prepared anytime. So when you look at the story of the 10 virgins were all sleeping, you know. So it means that there came a time that they all fell asleep. So it means you can just go about doing your own business, like Rodica. You can just go to your office. You can travel, you can do business. I can go to church, I can and preach. You are also a pastor, you can preach, you can do everything that you are doing. You can go to the shopping and buy clothes or food.
Oh, that is nice. Yes.
We can do everything, we can sleep. But in the course of doing everything, so you see, preparing hasn't got to do with living some type of, going to live on the desert, or going to live, you know, at some odd place, or behave oddly, or get out of normal life. No, he just says, whatsoever you are doing, just be prepared. So right now, even as we are here, we are prepared. If it should happen, we will just be caught up. Or whatsoever the Lord wants to do, he will do. We are prepared in our heart and in our face, the way we live. We know we are real.
I agree with your point of view, but when I was very young, as Andrea,
yes.
Was also these topics, the Lord is coming.
Yes.
And some preachers gave some years, maybe
yes.
that time and so on. And many young people that time was disappointed, myself a little bit too, not to study so much, because why? Because the Lord is coming. Mm-hmm. And other people also told me, not marry, because the Lord is coming. Mm-hmm. Not born a baby, because
the Lord is
no
coming.
Future for this child, and so on. What do you think? How it's for people at your age looking, in this generation, looking to this story?
Yes, to be very honest, I also had a time where I was like, oh, maybe tomorrow Jesus is coming, so I shouldn't work, I shouldn't go to school, I should just stay quietly at home, but then later on I was also like, okay, I just have to live my life, and then you know, God will come whenever he wants to come. And to be very honest, for my age group, I think it's quite difficult because some of us are like, we get attracted by the world, especially nowadays. I don't know how it is in Romania, but in Holland, there's so much to do, so many things that can distract you from God. And to be very honest, I also was in a place where I got a little bit distracted. But some things happened to me, and now I saw that God was so real. Mm-hmm. And I got back. And now I can see that it's very important just to follow Jesus fully. And if you do that, then actually you are always prepared. And it doesn't matter when he comes, you just live your life. But if he comes, then you are ready to go with him. Yeah,
and we can also add that the Bible also describes it. It said that day will come like a thief in the night, so it's still saying that it would not tell us when the Lord is going to come.
Yes, yeah. And other Bible words tell us that the season will not stop.
Yes,
people will marry.
Yes.
People will. Take care.
Yes.
About the garden and so on.
Yes.
So we'll never stop this.
Yes.
When I was your age, I read an article where was a word from Martin Luther.
Mm-hmm.
And he told like this: if the Lord is coming tomorrow, today I plant a tree.
Yes.
Oh, how nice.
Yes.
I thought.
Yes.
Okay, if this man of the reform, mm-hmm, thought like this, then I should respect and,
yes,
also go to school.
Yeah.
And do everything.
Yeah.
That it's normal to my age.
Yes.
And now I'm old, so I'm oh, mother with big children. I do a lot of studies. I run a company and so on. And I think Lord doesn't expect from me to do nothing.
Yes.
Only to stay and to wait.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And when we come back also to all those who tell people that they know when the Lord is coming with dates and everything. A lot of queer, very, very, very strange stories and that you hear. They're just false prophets and teachers. And the Bible is just clear about this, you know. So if Jesus said that no one knows, nothing can change the Word of God. We must go back to the Word of God when we get this type of prophecies or whatever they are. And read it and see, does it match with this? If Jesus says you won't know it. So who are you to come and tell us tomorrow, or you've seen it in a vision of that and that? And that's why people are being misled. I think we just have to be prepared, and we won't even be worried anymore.
Somebody told me a story that was a shoemaker.
Yes.
And he was repairing the shoes for other people, and somebody asked him, what are you doing? Look, I'm waiting the Lord, and in between I repay some shoes. So this story
exactly
tell me that
exactly,
everything we do, first we have to wait the Lord.
Yes.
We are waiting the Jesus to come back.
Yes.
But in between we do this talk.
Exactly.
Show.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
amen.
True.
Amen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Let's come back to the Matthew 25, and maybe for the people not read yet this, please tell in short the,
yes,
story.
You know, it's just Jesus was telling the story about the 10 virgins. And they were supposed to be bridesmaids for a wedding. The Bible normally calls Jesus the bridegroom of the church. Matthew 9:15 tells us Jesus is the bridegroom of the church. So significantly, the one they were going to, the bridegroom they were going to wait for and walk in procession with was Jesus, okay? So these nine virgins went and they were supposed to take their lamps with them. These lamps were supposed to have oil in them. Unfortunately, five of them took oil. They had lamps with oil in it. And the other ones didn't. Their lamp was not filled with oil at all. So they went and waiting for the bridegroom to come. The procession was supposed to take place, of course, if it would be at midnight, if you read the story, there would be a cry of somebody that's going to shout and say the bridegroom was in. And because of that, they can now rise up and go into the procession. But unfortunately, what happened was that the bridegroom kept so long that they all fell asleep. This is what I was saying. Both the wise ones, virgins, and the foolish virgins all fell asleep. So all of a sudden, unexpectedly, there came that shout that there comes the bridegroom. So they all woke up. So there came an awakening anyway because they all fell asleep. So here we should also make it clear. The fact that they were wise didn't mean that they kept awake throughout. You see, they were wise, but they couldn't hold their sleep. So that's what I'm saying. We can also wait for the Lord doing everything. Unexpectedly, they also fell asleep. And finally, they had oil in their lamp, so they could just trim it, and it started to burn. And they ran and went out to meet the bridegroom. It would be dark by then, so the light was very important. But let's put it this way. The foolish ones, meanwhile, had no oil. Before they went out, they started to beg quickly. Can you give us oil? Our lamps are gone
empty.
Off. Yes, they are empty. And they said, very sorry. We love you so much, but we are so sorry. We can't share this with you. If not, we will be left without enough oil. You know what? You can go just up there and you can buy oil. So they ran out because there was no any other choice. You know, there was no any other choice. So when they left in the course, everything was done. The bridegroom came, took them in, and they were gone. And the doors were shut. But when we come to the significance, I don't know if you want to talk about it now. The significance of the light is also very important because this light was supposed to help them to see in the dark because it was midnight. But when we see the symbolic meaning of light, it's we, the children of God, or Christians, are light in the dark world. And when we are there, we need to shine so that people can see the light and they will come to Jesus. They had nothing to offer the 10 virgins, and that's quite sad. I think that the 10 virgins, the wise virgins, had that spirit of God quickening them, you know, and that's very, very important. Significant for the fact that they had oil in their lamp. We all know oil is the Holy Spirit, and we know that Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, is working in us and transforming us and causing us, like I was saying, bearing fruit, to wait and to do the things of the Lord, to live as he expects us to live, out of grace, through faith. So they have working faith, they had grace, and they were just doing what was expected of them. When you look at it, five other foolish virgins, we can compare these ones to just what we see normally in the church, that there are people in church, whether they are lost, been church for long or for short, they are not transformed. They put all the blame on somebody. They leave one leg in the church, the other one in the world. They do anything at all. They go anywhere. They waste a lot of time. They are not in the word. They are not in prayer. They just say, oh, we are saved and we are in church. But it's important to know one thing. Church cannot save us. People cannot save us. We cannot also. And they said, I'm a member of this church. I go to this church. This person is my pastor. It's all nice. But at the end, it will mean nothing. So they had all that nice things. But you could see that Jesus didn't know them. When you look at the whole story at the end, I don't know you. And that's what's so sad. That can this be said of the church? Yes. This is the story Jesus told. But the reality is that it is true, and it is very important, and it's a wake-up call for us all to know that, hey, if there's anything we need to repent about our lives and to radically look at ourselves and say, it's time for me to change. I want to be real. I want to read the Word. I want the Holy Spirit to help me to live the Word, and I want to be able to preach the Word too. So it's not only anything, but you need to also preach the word.
What do you think? Why five wise, five foolish? It's half-half the percentage, or the Lord want to give us the meaning? So the chances are equal to be wise or to be wise.
Yes. This also got to do with the choice. It's just, it's either you choose to be wise or you choose to be foolish. I don't think the number, of course, numbers are significant, but I don't think here the Lord wants to make any significance on that particular number, because it can also be one foolish or two foolish or three, 10, seven. What matters is the choice they made, to be foolish or to be wise.
It's the same access, yes, to be in, yes, this or in this,
yes,
group.
Okay. Either you are foolish or you are wise.
Mm-hmm. It's very easy to be like one or like the,
yeah,
other.
Yeah, that.
You already started to explain the symbols.
Yes.
I think makes sense to continue with the lambs, with the oils, the virgins,
okay,
all those are,
yes,
important to be understood,
yes,
correct?
Those symbols. I think one of the symbols I want to talk about is the cry of the midnight. I love that so much, because this particular parable is something that people say, oh, I know this story, I know the parable of 10 virgins. What's wrong about this? Just simple. But anytime I read the Bible, there is something new. There is something that you know, but more revelation, more opening of your eyes on this word by the Holy Spirit. And I saw that I was not being caught up on all these symbols, because there are things that you know already and grown with it as a child of God or someone in the word. Oil, you know, it's the Holy Spirit and all the symbols. You know that the virgins, you know what it means. That's, like I said, wise, foolish, not living real, and not sinning. But this cry of the at midnight is very, very, really touched me. Hey, still, there is a cry. There is someone that cried so the tent could wake up. Because you remember, the 10 were sleeping.
Yes.
So if he did not shout, they would have all slept. So the 10 virgin, anyway, somewhere that awakening came, even though they were still in the word and they were living right, that voice was important. So I think that what's this telling us? It is very, very important that we will have in the body of Christ. And I know God himself is anointing people, men and women. And I continue to also stress women. Because men have no problem to preach the gospel or announce the gospel or warn anyone. But it's always a problem when women are going to speak. So women are also called to just announce and to warn. So that was a warning sign, a voice that would say, get up. You know, the bridegroom is coming. And it should continue in the church. So even though you are in the word, you constantly still need correction. You constantly need awakening, motivation, like you were saying, encouragement. Because even if you are in the word, sometimes there are things that happen that breaks your heart. There are things that happen that discourages you. There are things that happen even in your journey as persecutions, different types of persecutions. So those voices are important. And sometimes you like to give up. So wake up, it's also something that it's good for that sign for the wise virgins. And for the best part of it, it is really an awakening for the sleeping ones, the foolish one. You know, this wake up, the bride is coming. We must have these many voices all over the place, in the church, outside the church, to the unbelievers, non-Christians, and Christians. So no one should say this call. Of course, this 10 virgins signifies the church, but I know the heart of Jesus for the lost. And we must still be telling them. We must still be telling family members. We must still press in on to them with love of God and not give up on them. And even if they won't listen to us, continue to pray for them. And that is your warning sign that get up, live real. The Lord is coming. It's very, very important today.
I understand something new, that the cry comes not from universe.
Yes.
We should be a voice.
Yes.
And we should be a voice through preaching,
yes,
or to praying.
Yes.
Maybe somebody don't want to hear our cry.
You need to pray.
We can speak to God about those people.
Yes.
To wake up.
Yes.
What means unexpected delay?
Yeah. Mm. The unexpected delay. A delay means did not happen at the time expected. So that is a delay, not happening at an expected time. So, and a delay also is it happened later. It's something happening later. So you can have a delay in flight. You were supposed to.
It's not something that we like.
Yes, exactly. You were supposed to fly, like last we were coming here and we had a delay. So your driver have to wait for longer time. So he will say, what a delay. So they were also expecting that the Lord will come, the bridegroom will come at a particular time. By then all the lamps were burning too. But unfortunately, there was a delay. And that's what the Lord told us. He won't tell us when he's coming. So there can be a delay. So we Christians who are in the Word, who are living Christ, have to take this very serious, because you can be motivated today and you are doing everything well, you're doing your best, but when it delays, the Bible said a time will come when the love of many will run cold. It's because of the delay. Many bad things will be happening. Like he said, the signs, a lot of calamities, a lot of bad things, unfair things, people not kind, people doing wickedness that will be so unimaginable, yet people, and that will cause people to be discouraged in the Lord. And some of them may give up. Their love for the Lord will run cold, meaning they'll get discouraged, and some even walk out from their faith. And so we should all be aware of this delay as Christians. And for those who have not repented yet, come inside and just press on to the end.
I have a question for Andrea. Yes. Regarding this symbol virgins, purity, how do you think about this symbol in the meaning of the people, Christian people your age?
Yes, I think that the virginity is also the real virginity, like the physical one, so that we have to make sure our bodies are pure for God, and because we are actually a temple of the Holy Ghost. And I know a lot of young people struggle with this kind of things, but even if you have seen that, maybe if you did something wrong and you're going back to God, then I think it's also, now actually that's when the five virgins might have waken up earlier and got new oil. I think a lot of young people are in that stage. So they'll get that new oil, and then I think it's very, very important that we stay and keep that oil fresh, and we refill ourselves through reading the Bible and speaking with each other, young people together, because then you can strengthen yourself. But I think it's really got to do with also how you live, just your pure faith in God.
So the waiting, the Lord, have also something with our bodies.
Yes, yes. It's written in the Bible that we really have to, because we need the Holy Spirit to be filled, and also to continue to press in with our faith and to be able to do things through faith. And if we don't have that, then if we can't keep ourselves pure, then the Holy Spirit can't stay with us. So, and the nice thing about Jesus is, even if you have done something wrong, I'm not saying that you can just do whatever you want to do and then come back, but if you did something wrong and you are sorry for it and you really repent, then God will make you pure and the Holy Spirit can come with you and help you more.
We are very close for the end of this talk show, yeah. But we can to explain the meaning in the last minutes. We remember in the Jesus times, not everybody understood the meaning of these parables, only the disciples.
Yes.
And in this case, we are the disciples
Amen.
Of Jesus.
Amen.
Even we are men or women,
yes.
It's not different.
No.
And what is the meaning, the message for us?
The message right now for each and every one of us and is that we need to be prepared. No matter what we are doing, we need to fix our eyes on Jesus. He must be the center of our life. He must be our hope. He must be our faith, our everything. The Bible says he's the utter and finisher of our faith. When we have burdens, when we are overwhelmed, when things are weighing us down, we have to lift up our eyes and look up to Jesus. There is every solution in the Word of God. And when we continue like this, there is no way that we will miss that day. There is time for us, even now, to repent. If we are also not living according to the Word of God or living to please the Lord, like Andrea said, God is a loving God, a God who loves us. And he just wants us to know we've done wrong and repented from it. Come back and just follow him up. And he will refill us with his Holy Spirit, because he is the source, that's the oil, through whom we can do all things. In Jesus' name, amen.
Where we can buy this oil? Because people, these foolish virgins, try to buy in the last minutes, like in the airport, before the fly, we go to buy something more.
I think this is one of the most interesting questions, Rinika, thank you. Where can we buy this oil? That's quite really, you know, you can't buy this oil anywhere. You cannot, they went and they would not be able to buy it. You can only buy, no, we don't buy it, but it is only through submission, accepting Jesus Christ and asking him to refill you with this oil. You know, that is it. Just ask Jesus and he will fill you with the oil. So you can't buy it. You can't take it from anyone. You can't borrow it. You can't also move on somebody's oil. The car cannot move on someone's oil. You cannot go to heaven through somebody's works or through belonging to a denomination or a church or a pastor or anything or a group. But the only one who can give you this oil to be able to press hard and live to meet the Lord Jesus Christ is Jesus Christ himself who can do that.
Of course. Thank you. And how we know if it's enough oil or not? How we can check the level? You know, I'm working in the automotive area and people check the oil level.
Personally, that's also quite interesting. Personally, this is my own personal experience. Anytime I'm irritated, anytime I'm getting to be too anxious, anytime I'm getting to be, I feel so emotional, weight over me, and I'm going to start nagging or, you know what, murmuring, or anytime I see this type of spirit coming over me, I get to know I'm getting empty. The Bible says we can be refilled and be refilled with this, with the oil of God, the Spirit of God. So I go to the Lord. I spend time deep in prayers, ask God to fill me with the Holy Spirit. And many people think sometimes they need their pastor. So when pastor is not there, they will never be filled with oil. Or when that brother or sister or that person who is so, you know, I think that sometimes, you know, it was so difficult that I put my hand on my own head and I just pray into my life. And it works. And I get filled up. I've always constantly put my hands on my own head, my two hands, and I pray and ask the Lord to fill me. Sometimes I also just open up my hands and I ask him to fill me. Jesus is so real and he wants to really do that.
Thank you. Andrea, what is your meaning about this story from the Bible?
I was also thinking just now that actually you can see that the five foolish bridesmaids, their oil lamps were not completely filled. And it's funny because there's a lot of, especially around the youth, people feel empty. I think people are always searching for something in their life. Mm-hmm. And sometimes they think that having fun or doing going into your work and just work and focus on that only can fulfill you. Or sometimes it are other things like being with friends or shopping or whatever you want, you like. And then they think it's almost the same, but it's not. And I think also, that everyone actually is searching for God, but they don't know it. And sometimes they do, but then it's just that like they know who God is and that's all. So I think the five foolish bridesmaids, their oil lamps are half full because, yeah, they can't complete themselves with the purity of God only. And the wise ones, they know that God is the one that can fulfill them. And I think that's also why they are alert and they are ready to go. And that's what I got out of the story.
Thank you, Andrea.
You're welcome.
I'm so happy to hear this explanation and to have this talk show with a mother and a daughter.
God bless you.
Thank
God
you.
Bless
and
you too. Thank you.
Keep you connected in the spirit for many years.
Thank you.
And to be together a good ministry.
Amen. Yes, amen.
Thank you so much.
Yes.
And let's have a nice time in Romania next day.
Yes, we will.
Dragi telespectatoare, dragi telespectatori, este momentul să ne luăm rămas bun. Vă mulțumim pentru atenția cu care ne ascultați și vă așteptăm să revedeți o nouă ediție a emisiunii Pentru Noi Femeile. săptămâna viitoare. La revedere!
O emisiune sponsorizată de Matero.